It's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
That was the moment watched live by more people around the world than any before it, and perhaps since. In the moment, because of that radio breakup, Walter Cronkite famously missed the exact quote and asked for clarification on the air. Armstrong insisted that while he may not have pronounced every syllable, the quote was, "That's one small step for a man, one giant leap for mankind." Neil Armstrong, the introverted Purdue engineer, the reluctant American hero, left us 7 years ago. The two surviving members of the Apollo 11 crew, Buzz Aldrin, Michael Collins, were in the Oval Office today. Both men are chasing 90 years of age. With us to talk about the mission, the legacy, is a genuine spaceman. It happens to be the title of his book. Veteran NASA astronaut Mike Massimino has spent a total of 571 hours and 47 minutes in space, completing four spacewalks totaling, you got to sit here and take this, 30 yes. hours and 4 minutes of tethered time. He's a PhD and an engineer by trade who went on two missions to repair and upgrade the Hubble Space Telescope. As we said, his book is called Spaceman, An Astronaut's Unlikely Journey to Unlock the Secrets of the Universe. It is great
Brian,
to see you
great
again.
Great to see you. Thank you
so
for having
much
me.
For coming
in. My pleasure to be here. Thank you.
I was the ripe old age of 10. You were six.
Six,
when this
nearly
happened.
Seven. Yeah.
I remember my mother in tears. I remember watching it on a small black and white television set. What does the legacy of Apollo 11 mean to a guy like you?
It brings back very pure emotional memories of that time for me. And I knew it was an important event, but to me it was something really special. For me, I think it defined what I thought about the world, who I wanted to be when I grew up. That's what that meant to me. And I knew it was important to a lot of people, but I also knew to me it seemed a little bit more than it meant a little bit more than it meant to others. And I think it's the greatest achievement we ever had. I remember as a little kid, six years old, thinking this is the most important thing that's happened in 500 years, and it's the most important thing that's going to happen for the next 500 years. And 500 years from now, little kids that were in school like we were back then, 500 years from now, are going to be learning about what happened 50 years ago tomorrow.
Last night on this broadcast, I talked about the courage of all this, an aspect I don't think gets enough attention. The courage of knowing that while there was a button to push on the dashboard of the LEM, there was no guarantee they were coming back. No guarantee.
Yeah.
Those rockets had never fired on the surface of the
That's
moon
right.
before. So my question for you is, an engineer by trade, an MIT Columbia type with an intellect we can all stand back and be amazed at, where did you learn courage, the claustrophobia of the space? You got into a spacecraft that had exploded before.
Yes, yeah.
Where did you learn all that? You weren't a jet jockey like
I wasn't, Brian. It was a new experience for me. A lot of my friends were military test pilots, had done things, fought in combat, and they were used to, I think, these things more than I was. So this was all new to me. I think what got me through those things was having that dream of wanting to go to space and seeing that there was a real purpose in it. And I think that passion can and the meaningfulness in what you're doing can take you a long way to let you take those risks. And I think that in my case, what I really felt about the space program is that what we were doing was that important that it was worth the risk that we were taking. And the other thing was kind of strange. I never thought how I would react to some of these things. But when you're in those situations and it's risky or you might get scared, you realize that getting scared is not going to help. And that it's not going to, if you're trying to solve a problem, if you're in a dangerous situation, it's not going to help you to be nervous or scared. And so for some reason, it disappears. I don't know why that happened. I never would have expected that to happen. But that's what happened to me when I was nervous about something or should have been nervous about something. It kind of went away somehow.
I want to tell folks that in citing both Tom Hanks and John Glenn, your book, perhaps because of your own wiring, does the best job of talking about what it's like up there, what trying to sleep your first night is like, what trying not to erp your first 2 days up there is like. When people come up and ask you, how do you answer the what it's like question?
It's a mixture of things. I think there's a bit of stress involved because you want to do your job well. There's the uncertainty of how it's going to go. The danger is going to get to you? Is it going to be a bad day or a good day when you launch? How is the mission going to go? So you've got that stressful part of it, but it's also very magical. And getting a chance to do that for me was a dream come true. And what you see out there, looking at our planet, the beauty of it, it looks like a complete paradise. And getting out in spacewalking where the whole sky opens up, it's like going out into the playground. If you're looking outside in the window, it's a pretty day outside, and you go outside and the whole sky opens up. That's what it was like going out to spacewalk. The whole universe kind of opens up to you, and I really felt like a spaceman being out there. It's just these wonderful experiences. And I also enjoyed a lot of the technical part of it, of the planning and the preparation of how we were going to do things and figuring things out. That was a lot of the pleasure in the job as well.
Hey there, I'm Chris Hayes from MSNBC. Thanks for watching MSNBC on YouTube. If you want to keep up to date with the videos we're putting out, you can click subscribe just below me or click over on this list to see lots of other great videos.